but nearly. Okay, well, good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to this poet session in search of a muse on writing poetry. My name's Ruth Padel, and I have the honor of presenting to you six prize-winning, famous, spectacular, and inspirational poets from many different places. And before I introduce them, I wanted to say, I mean, we're living in a very dangerous and quickly changing world. Tomorrow is going to see the change of a president in the United States. Where Kate and I come from, we've just had an earthquake in our political scene, which is going to change the lives of everybody. Everybody is very nervous, and in a nervous and dangerous time, it seems to me, I don't know if these poets will agree, that actually poetry comes into its own in a special way. It's a portable, a cheap and economic art, unlike some, and it's something that is very personal to everybody and yet is universalizable. And so I just want to tell you where all these poets come from. So first of all, we have here Vladimir from St. Lucia in the Caribbean. We have Tishani, Doshi from Chennai, from Madras. She said she gave me leave to call it Madras, but I, being respectful of what India is now, felt I better call it Chennai. We have Anne Waldman from America. And I hope some of you heard her this morning, wasn't it, you were reading. Then we have Auður from Iceland, from Reykjavik. She's brought her daughter with her. It's the first time in India. And I think we're going to hear a little bit of Icelandic in her work as well. Then we have Ishion Hutchinson, who is from two places, really. He's from Jamaica, but he spent the last 10 years in the United States. So there are two places of inspiration closely connected. And Kate Tempest from my own country, from the United Kingdom. We have a lot of poets, and we want to hear poems from poets before you hear everything else. So what I've asked them to do is to each say a poem and then talk a little about what inspired them. They all are inspirational poets themselves, but what inspired them? I think actually it's a rather grand word, and poets often don't like being asked that. And people often say to you, how did you come to think of something? Or what inspired you? I myself don't like being asked in that way very much, because it seems such a grand way of going about something which comes to you naturally when you're interacting with the world. But whatever that beginning is, that thing that used to be called a muse, there is a beginning. And we're going to find out from these different poems what sparked them off. So we're going to start with Vladimir from St. Lucia.
Okay. I would just like to say that the poem is called Corbeau, which is a bird. And I guess after when we talk, the relevance of that bird will become a little more apparent.
Can you hear all right in the back? No. Can you hear me, okay?
Yeah, you could hear me? Right. No, well, I can't move to that mic, no.
Because it's...
We're chained to these chairs.
I will project. Corbeau. Corbeau rises and flaps our world downward. Because the earth comes to terms with itself first through its birds, looming above the identities of days, rubbing shoulders with rain. Corbeau rises and lowers our earth to us like bait, because it is ours, and in his wisdom, politely, quietly, he waits, He waits politely until we have finished ourselves. Kobo rises, removes himself from the world or the world from himself, maneuvering through the low, difficult blue until he is all sky. He rises dimly, darkly, with his neck of mail. Shard of night, diving swiftly, pray, 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 he says. His business is what remains. Thank you.
Now, Vladimir, would you like to say a little about how you came to write that, or how it happened?
Right, yeah, the Kobo is it's the word that is used mostly in Trinidad and in St. Lucia. I spent quite a bit of time in Trinidad as well, so the poem was written there and out of there. But it is a vulture. Really.
A vulture.
Yeah, it really is a vulture. That's the name we have for it. But the thing is, the bird has taken on a certain kind of, it's become a kind of character, a living character, both notorious and kind of sacred at the same time. In Jamaica, you have an equivalent in the bird, they call the John Crow as well. So I think the source of the poem for me started off with, I suppose, realizing that that bird was somehow related to what a scholar, Achille Mbembe, called the deep archives of a culture, where something in that culture had connected with that bird so that it had risen to that symbolic height as
Did
well.
You say
for
the
them.
Deep archives?
The deep archives of
deep
a sensibility.
Archives of a culture.
It's not my tomb, by the way. It's Achille Mbembe's tomb, but I'm using it here perhaps a little liberally. But it came out of that. I realized that there was a significance to this bird, and it was being given all of these characteristics. It inhabits proverbs and all of these things, and I wondered about it. So that's kind of the source. But the vehicle is, I think it was after reading Ted Hughes' poems about Crow that I thought, okay, I could probably do this. I could probably write a Crow poem about what I wanted to write all along about this bird that was fascinating me.
Yes.
Somehow, yeah. But it's the notoriety of the bird, I think, that is most pronounced in the culture, and it's kind of what I wanted to capture in the poem.
So the bird represents something in the psyche that is threatening, tricky, exciting, watchful.
Yes, and I think it's both the bird as a symbol of these things, but I also think there's a significance that the bird is able to take on that kind of character in a culture. It says something about the kind of realities that that culture chooses to authorize, the kind of perhaps permeability of lives between human and animal life and so on. So, I mean, it really struck me as something, I don't think I could fully articulate it, but it struck me as something that was important to that culture. And I would want to, you know, contribute my part to at least starting a conversation about it.
Did it take you a long time, that poem?
No, actually, that was, well, I mean, if, the writing of it did not take long, but I think I may have, you know, there was the first links of it was there a long time before I actually wrote the poem.
Yeah.
So yeah, it did and did not take a long time.
Yes and no. Yeah.
Yes, and no.
Thank you.
Yes.
So next, Tishani Doshi, please.
Okay. So I'm going to read a newish poem. Can you hear me? Yes? It's a slight departure for me. I also have a bird in my poem. It's a kind of duck called the Northern Shoveler. I found it on the beach one day and I tried to save it. But mainly this poem is about Patrick Swayze. And I don't know how many of you know about him. When I was 14, I adored this man, and I was trying to remember what it was like to be 14. So this is, I'll talk more about the poem later, but this is called Ode to Patrick Swayze. At 14, I wanted to devour you, the twang, the strut, the perfect proletarian butt in the black pants of you. I wanted a man like you to sashay into town and teach me how to be an aeroplane in water. I didn't want to be a baby. I wanted to be your baby. I wanted revenge. I wanted to sue my breasts for not living up to potential. I wanted Jennifer Grey to meet with an unfortunate end and not have a love affair with a ghost. At 14, I believe you'd given birth to the word preternatural. And when mother came home one day, waving her walking shoes, saying, I lost my soul in the Theosophical Society, I wanted to dance as recklessly as the underside of that shoe. I wanted to be a pebble in the soft heel of you, to horse whisper and live on a ranch in Texas and love my blonde wife forever and have creases around my eyes and experience at least one goddamn summer where I could be like the wind, sexy and untrammeled and dirty. And it was only after I found my own Johnny and got rid of him. Only yesterday, when I rescued a northern shoveler from crows on the beach, his broken wing squished against the crockery of my ribs. Only after setting him down at the edge of a canal where he sank into the long, patient task of dying, that I realized what I'd wanted most was to be held by someone determined to save me. Someone against whom I could press my unflourishing chest, who'd offer me not just the time of my life, but who'd tear out reams of his yellowing pancreas and say, here, baby, eat.
Wow. Oh my
gosh. So, obviously, if you have a PhD in Patrick Swayze, you will get all the hidden references of this poem, but the poem came about, so my husband and I watch movies together, and we are of somewhat different generations and different cultures. So he put me through the experience of watching Kieslowski's Decalogue, and in return, I thought it would only be fair for him to watch this great American classic that I had watched 35 times, Dirty Dancing. So this was the kind of exchange that happened. And you know, I was driving one day and I found the soundtrack for the film, and I'd completely forgotten that intensity of emotion you feel when you are 14. And I was trying to think about whether if I had the opportunity, would I really want to feel like that? And I think part of me thinks, no, I'm done with that now and I don't want to go back. But then I rescued this duck. Not really rescued because it eventually died, but I found this duck on the beach and I held it. And something about the frailty, I guess, of that creature and its thing reminded me of the frailty of being 14 and being exposed really to these terrific intensity of emotions that I somehow channeled in this poem through Patrick Swayze, of course, who died of pancreatic cancer. So I've been thinking about death and thinking about love and, you know, basic poetic themes like that, so.
It's so interesting because in my experience of other people talking to other poets as well as my own writing, poems often come about when, as it were, three roads meet. And you've got three roads meeting there. You've got you and your husband and the intensity of, do I want still to be 14? No, thank you very much. It was wonderful, some of it at the time, but not anymore. And then the duck, the shoveler, and then the death from the pan. And those three are coming together. And you can never tell what's going to make a poem, can you? And it's fascinating.
Yeah. Yes.
And I must say, just the rhythm of where you're going, and the rhythm of all of it, and then suddenly have the pancreas at the end. Can you read those last two lines again, three lines, when you suddenly get that, and you thought, whoops, I didn't know that was coming.
It says, who'd offer me not just the time of my life, but who'd tear out reams of his yellowing pancreas and that say, here we
are. That is such a surprise for a listener, isn't it? It's, my goodness, you know. Mm. Well, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, our next poet is Ishion Hutchinson from Cornell and from Jamaica.
Hello? Is this good? Can you hear me? Okay, thank you. The poem is called The Difference. They talk oil in heavy jackets and plaid over their coffee. They talk Texas and the North cold, but mostly oil and Obama. Voices dipping, vexed. And then they talk Egypt, failing, Greek, broken. And it takes cash for France, not charity. And I'd rather speak Russia than Ukraine, one says in rubles, than whatever. Whatever the trouble, because there is sea and gold, a tunnel, wherever right now, and anyhow, Belarus. Oh, I will show you something, conspiring coins. This one, China, and they marvel. Their minds hatched crosses, a frontier zeroed not by voyage or pipeline, nor the milk foam of God. No, not the gutsy weather they talk, frizzled, the abomination worsening, opulence to squalor, never the inverse.
Thank you. Would you like to say a bit about how it came about?
Yes, I will try to. I feel compelled because I'm sitting next to Ava. And the poem began when I was reading the great Icelandic novelist, Laxness, and the novel Independent People. I'm not sure of the Icelandic title. This great epic of a journey through the hardship of politics, but living in a way that is completely independent and courageous. And the novel really inspired me to want to consider those topics in light of current American politics. And I'm not sure how the two things came together, but that's the origin of the poem itself. Mm. But I remember though the moment of composing the poem, sensing a great nervousness everywhere I went, and people talking in huddles, and in the novel Independent People by Laxness, you have that sense of this conspirational activity happening where people talked in secret, and the marvelous thing and marvelously frightening thing was how that talking amongst each other in isolation is much part of a bigger frightening picture. And so I wanted a poem that is fragmented and exploring the idea of how the private and the public converge when we're living through a nervous political moment.
Exactly, yeah. I mean, it's very difficult to write a poem out of anger and fear so rawly, but you've done it sort of beautifully through the fragments. And also this sense of the they, whoever they are, they're talking about things which we are not part of.
Right.
Yeah. Thank you. Kate.
I cheated. I just took my microphone off because I felt really strange being chained to the chair, and I abandon the ship, but I just it made me feel really awkward. So I thought that maybe I'll do the explanation of what the poem, where the poem began, before doing the poem, because it's been really interesting to listen to the different moments and how the intention and then the poem seem to go hand in hand. but this is the beginning of a longer piece. I'd written a long story that was set at one moment on one street. I knew the characters, but I couldn't work out how to get into the story. I was concerned about just starting too abruptly, and I realized that I needed a kind of gradual zoom. So this is a poem that began in a functional need rather than in a kind of moment of inspiration. I needed to get into a story. So this is the beginning of a longer poem called Let Them Eat Chaos. Picture a vacuum, an endless and unmoving blackness. Peace, or the absence at least of terror. Now see, in amongst all this space, that speck of light in the furthest corner, gold as a pharaoh's coffin. Now follow that light with your tired eyes. It's been a long day, I know, but look. Watch as it flickers and then roars into fullness and fills the whole frame, blazing a fire you can't bear the majesty of. Here is our sun. And see how the planets are dangled around it and held in that intricate dance. There is our Earth. Our Earth. Its blueness soothes the sharp burn in your eyes. Its contours remind you of love, that soft roundness, the comfort of ocean and landmass. Picture the world. Older than she ever thought she could get. She looks at herself as she spins, arms loaded with the trophies of her most successful child, the pylons and mines, the power plants shimmer in her still, cool breath. Now is that a smile that plays across her lips? Or is it the tremor of dread? Is it the sadness of mothers as they watch the fates of their children unfold? In now, in kaleidoscopic vision, the colors like drugs in your belly churning, your skin pulled loose as a pup's, shaken then flattened, and everything's flashing and the waves are magnified as they roll up towards you, and you're tiny as sand, just a speck. Now as you approach the surface, all of that peace that you felt is replaced with this furious, never-known passion. You're feeling the people. Their faces are bright in your blood. You are feeling. You want to be close to them, closer, because these are your species, your kindred. Where have you landed? Uncurl yourself. Stand up and look at your limbs all intact, clothed in the fashion. This is a city. Let's call her London. And these are the only times you have known. At any given moment in the middle of a city, there's a million epiphanies occurring in the blurring of the world within the person and the world beyond the curtain. There's a quivering. The litter in the alleyway is singing. People meet by chance, fall in love, drift apart again. Underage drinkers walk the park and watch the dark descend. The workers watch the clocks and they fiddle with their Parker pens while the grandmothers haggle with the market men. Here, where the kids play and laugh until they fall apart. It's kiss chase and dancing till it's mistakes and darkened rooms. Too fast, too soon, too slow, too long. We move around all day, but we can't move on.
Wonderful. So you, that was a poem that you wrote for the beginning of something else.
Yeah, I was working on I like to tell stories. I think narrative is everything at the moment. Well, eternally, in fact, in all life. But I was working on a story, you know, and so it's a slightly different kind of poetic mode when you're trying to work on a bigger piece, I find, than when you're just receiving an image or a moment and that sparks a little adventure that's got nothing to do with a bigger whole. It's a different kind of process. It doesn't quite feel as... Some of the magic goes out of it, but then you end up... It feels a bit more like technology, or, you know, it's an engine rather than a kind of breath. I don't know.
Yeah, you know where you want to go, I suppose. Whereas normally when you're writing a poem, you
it
don't.
It leads you. Yeah.
Yeah. But you had the magic coming in from the side.
I hope so.
Yes. Thank you. Let's. So, now we come to Auður.
I'd like to use the mic.
Yes. Poets' Revolution here. We're getting unchained. Wait.
Sorry, unbound. I thought I was going to. I'm going to copy Kate. Not in her performances, because no one can. She's unique.
Do you hear me? Okay. I'm want to be
like
near
to
you.
Sure.
So I've traveled far. I come from the edge of the world. It's called Iceland. And my speciality among those distinct poets is to write in a language that no one understands. It's a minority, marginal language called Icelandic. So they all write in English. Actually, I'm an art historian. I studied art history, art theory in Paris. And I had no intention of becoming a writer, even if I had always looked at the world in a slightly skewed way. And teachers were complaining to my parents that I had too much imagination. But when I settled in Paris, when I went to Paris to study, I found myself in between space, in between two languages. I became a foreigner. I became a stranger. And even if I wrote all my theses and pieces in France, I was always a foreigner. But the strange thing was that I also became a foreigner in Icelandic, and I started to discover Icelandic in a new way. And I'm, as an art historian, I'm supposed to be a specialist in the visual world, everything that's that you can see. So I'm supposed to be able to read the visual world like other people read words, poems, books. And that's also something in between. So I became interested in this space, negative space, you say in visual art, but also in the space between words. It's, you can call it silence, and that's where my inspiration comes from silence. I would say that Iceland is like a monastery, big monastery, with those endless spaces and the silence. So, and I also became interested in what was between words, what's between things, and in what people did not say, and what they did not do. And then it led me down to different people, like blind people, deaf people, and I wrote my novels. I'm also a novelist and a playwright, and my novels have been translated into like 23 languages, but I've never wanted my poems to be translated. You might understand when I try to read it now. But so it's, for me, a poem is like whispering. I like the idea of writing for just one reader, the one who is sitting on your shoulder, and everything above that is extra. And poetry is like whispering from one person to another. And so I'm going to, since Icelandic is the language no one understands except for those 333,000 people in Iceland and a handful of translators, I'm going to give you an example of how it sounds. I know there are like three people here that will understand me. And so Upp frá því heimsæki ég skrýtna staðið við löngum stundum í annara manna svefnarbergjum, líkta af ókunnum kottum, róta í náttborðskúfum, hnífaparaskúfum, kennara, presta og andofsmanna frá Rauðahafi til eystri Rangár. Skil öll sjónarmið geng fram í flekkleysi og á líka bátt alla daga ársins. So this is how Icelandic sounds, and I thank you very much. And the translation, it's actually like a prose, a love relationship between a woman who has only one leg and a blind lover, and it's called the book is called Ode to Glitter, and it's. What I read in Icelandic sounds something like this in English, but I have to remind you that it's not written in English, it's not my native tongue. So you just close your ears. The plan was just to open a minor vein. It's about the birth of a poet, something like that. Having run out of ink, not an artery, since then I visit strangers' bedrooms, sniffing unfamiliar pillows, fumbling through bedside drawers, cutlery drawers of teachers, nurses, militants. Let's go to bed and start to die a little, he says, and allows the white axe to drop onto the varnished window ledge, pursuing him in pink sneakers like an obedient dog with a waggling tail. In the face of an unknown, a woman is at her best. Tattooed skin stretches out across a freshly ironed sheet. You are such a beautiful compound, he says, sweeter than honey, fondling a body, stroking the spine, pecking the clavicle, probing the liver and kidneys. A blind man, did I forget to mention? Highlighting prepositions over, for, on. I wouldn't call it torture. Afterwards, he hands me a pencil to record the beauty. Such a soft pencil will last 15 words. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. I was just trying to sum up in my head what I felt each of our poems were about, and I found this word about with yours was rather difficult, but maybe it's about at one level how people respond to and touch each other.
Yeah, yes, probably the blind theme is everywhere in my, also in my novels. I somehow in this in between space I became interested in other senses like feeling, touching, smelling, tasting, so yeah.
Mm. Fantastic. Now, you're going to go around. So have you disentangled yourself?
Sort of. Thank you all, this has been wonderful. Thank you. So, can you hear me? Yes. This piece is called Problem Not Solving, and it was actually written at the Ghetto Vecchio in Venice, in Italy, the former Jewish quarter, when the people who lived there were very restricted. There were bridges on either end, there were curfews, they were not allowed out. This went on for hundreds of years. And a kind of meditation on that situation that then became resonant with this ongoing problem not solving of the Middle East. So standing in front of the Canaletto of Venice's Ghetto Vecchio, ghetto, the word for foundry, contemplating those arms, the arsenal, those arms and harms, I sit down in ghetto, I sit down in Ghetto Vecchio. So the old arms quarter, which was a ghetto for the Jews. And metal was cast in the dream of the ghetto, and metal was forged for cannons, 1390, in Ur, in Pre, in nightmare of ghetto, and laboratory of ghetto, a metal mentality, for it takes a long harm, a long arm, a long harm, harming this mentality of force, of problem not solving. Problem not solving your ghetto, and in the name of decree and forging a metal mentality with harming arms, and where you can live under a low ceiling, where you can live, and problem not solving 5,000 in a crammed room. Undream the nightmare, undream this nightmare, a nightmare not allowed into the light of other campos and canals, your arms held and not being able to reach out across a map. A city divided and problem not solving, undream problem not solving, the nightmare of ghetto, or problem not solving your nightmare of ghetto. You want to stretch your human fleshly arms outside the walls towards campos and canals. You want to stretch your rare fleshly arms out of here, reach out of here, reach out of harm's way towards campos and canals, but you can only live here in this curfew, this time, this pre-time, before the dawn until Napoleon allows. You can live elsewhere. Oh, please step outside. Oh, please step aside. You say to Palestine, you who were in pre-dreamtime ghetto, astride campos and canals, you are not my problem. You are my problem, not solving. And under Austrian rule, come back inside ghetto. And the nightmare, 1797, this pre-dawn state of arsenal, of Palestine, old way back, Palestine, what of its rip and tears, its tears and weeping, its ghetto, I mark this for you, I say this for you. Tears and more weeping, and then the dream of a full-fledged, full-time arsenal, tears and weeping toward metal. What to do? What to do? What to do? What do we have to do? 13 dead again in ghetto Palestine, when the now of problem not solving and long-range rocket revenge toward Ashkelon. No one heard in Ashkelon, 10 kilometers north of Gaza. Oh, remember Gaza and the revenge in the strikes, 13 dead in Gaza, ripped apart in Gaza, more dead in Gaza, in the fine elliptical gallery for women only. Here, my dear, down, dead, decimated sister, my one next to me in this dream, nightmare, and ghetto, an arsenal of ghetto. Oh, Palestine, describe the body parts you lifted from the trees and sifted down from the scattered trees of Zion, of Palestine, the wells of Zion, the scattered trees of Zion, the miracles and tribulations of Zion, of Palestine, the three ways to undream the problem. The dear dead body parts enter here, the dream, the nightmare of ghetto and end of ghetto, and say three times, I will not do to them what has been done to me. I will not do to them what has been done to me. I will not do to them what has been done to me. What to do? What to do? As the merchant, stranger, Shakespeare, ghetto, merchant works, the Banco Rosso, real and tangible, or other side hits Sedrat with Grad rockets from Iran, hits with metal mentality, forged in metal, hits the word sent rock, hits the word grot, hit with harm your problem not solving, problem not solving. Alliances of boys between 8 and 12, dear, dead body parts east of Jabalia, undream the dead, take back the word dead, not a jubilee, and more in Gaza, and more in ghetto Gaza. This is the old held vision of unsolved Zion, and now the guards in the nightmare that is new century's inventory of the state of arsenals, more arsenals, more arsenals than the unsolved, now divided, more than ever divided Palestine, and the building of more arsenals than the arms that harm and reach out and harm and harm and harm you. Human and fleshly, I will sit here, I will sit here, and I will sound here, and I will sound here, and reach out arms, human and fleshly, towards ghetto, towards Gaza.
Fantastic. Thank you. Thank you so much. I wanted to ask you a question. Should we try the Willis?
Sure.
Okay. I wondered, did you write that in Venice?
Yes.
Because it's so interesting. We were talking about where does a poem go, and you didn't presumably know you were going to write where you were going to get
no.
to. How long did it take?
I think I was taking notes and I was visiting some of the quarters there and looking at the site, you know, as a kind of map of some kind, and I was doing a couple of other little projects like this, you know, where you're resonant, this whole idea of the mind of the poet, all times are contemporaneous, and so you can try to get into locations through their history, and then just that, you know, the endless situation which we have going on as we speak, and now with Trump and company wanting to move the American embassy to Jerusalem, which is just insane and will up the whole, you know, ante of the problem. It just eats away at everything. So I think that's why I chose to read it today.
But wonderful. Yes. Thank you. Please let's give them. No, it's very. I mean, tomorrow is the 20th. So.
Oh. Help me. I want to move to India.
Iceland. What about coming to Iceland?
Yeah. Iceland.
Okay.
You're welcome.
Yeah, thank you.
So I thought if there was enough time, if there was enough time, I'll read one of my own. I wanted to honor all of them, but I'll read one too. In a way, it follows yours, because this is a huge problem that we're writing about. We're all addressing interesting, hurtful, dangerous things. But mine is only one person. This poem came out of a time when my daughter was doing an internship in the Helen Bamber organization in London, which works for asylum seekers. And she came home one day and they had been going through cases, reviewing cases of whom to help, because there are so many asylum seekers. And she was absolutely traumatized. I said, what is it? And she said, we had to go through a whole day of deciding against one person who has raped only 14 times and another who has raped 30 times, and those kinds of things, and the terrible cases that everybody was, and that is before this government in Britain that we have came in, of asylum seekers. So I was reading a book about asylum seeking, and this is a very, very short poem, but it's written by somebody who was in Cairo for a while, and in Cairo, where a lot of people coming up from different places in Africa come up to Cairo to try and get some sort of legitimate bit of paper in order to go to another country to find asylum. And the UN had invented a new stamp, which meant that, LOC, it was unverifiable, that their evidence was unverifiable. If you go, and you have one interview and you say, I am born such and such, my mother was born on such and such a day. And then 10 months later, because the bureaucracy takes that long, you have another interview. If you say the wrong date, if you can't remember, if you're frightened, then down comes the stamp on your file, and that's you. You cannot go. And it's such a small poem to follow yours, but it's the same idea that there are so many people in power over so many more fragile, vulnerable people at risk. And in a way, I suppose this picks up my response to Ishion's poem, that is, and also in so many ways to Kate and to Anne's, it's very, very hard to write a poem that really works well out of anger, because anger is such a huge emotion. And sometimes you have to approach it obliquely. Sometimes you can't bear to approach it obliquely. Okay, so this is just called Purple Ink. She has waited 3 years for this. Too ashamed to even half tell the young woman in spectacles tapping a purple barrow on a desk exactly what the soldiers did to her, each versatile in his turn. She gets wrong, date your mother was born, and sees a stamp the color of desert night descend on her file. So that was that was the poem I brought to today. I'm afraid it's not a very jolly, but we are not living in jolly times. And as I said, I think poetry is here for us to share things about what we feel about the world. So in a way, I'd like to go around again, maybe, and ask everybody, maybe starting with Kate this time, come back. Why do we write? Who are we writing for, and how does a poem pop up?
Well, I think that all we can do as writers is give all of our time and energy and lives to trying to facilitate ideas when they come. But when the idea itself comes, I believe that I don't know where it's come from. I haven't made it happen. And the proof of that is that I try endlessly to make it happen and it doesn't happen. You know, sometimes you work so hard at an idea to try and bring it into life and it's not happening, it won't come. When it does come for you, you have to have done everything you possibly can to be able to hold its hand and bring it down out of, you know, the other space where it lives through your shit human brain and out of your ridiculously faulted hand. And I'm not saying that about any of you lot, just my own brain and my own hand. You guys are got pretty good brains and hands. But like, I suppose what I mean is I don't know where it pops up from. All I know is that for some reason or another, some of us are born with a sensitivity tuned into a particular frequency where we have no choice but to listen out for it, live in service to it without wanting to sound too far-fetched, and for being moved by it when it comes.
Yeah, I think that's excellent. Actually, being in these spaces which are open, it feels a bit like how you are open, if you open yourself to ideas coming, words coming in. I like the birds come in sometimes. I like that. Ishion, what about you? What do you, this thing about you don't know where it comes from. Does it come from inside or outside? How does it feel to you?
How does it feel to me? Painful.
Did you get that? Painful. Yeah.
Are you hearing me? Can you hear me? Yes, okay. You guys are awake. I don't want to be flippant about it, but it's intolerable what happens when something
let's call it inspiration, for lack of a better word now, comes upon you. And it's a sort of exorcism. You're trying to get rid of this pressure, but there's no way to get rid of it. Like you said, it is now a part of you, and you have to live with it. I think you live with the failures, which happens more than the successes. The very great American poet Elizabeth Bishop once said that writing poetry is unnatural. And I think I understand more and more that what she means by that. It doesn't mean that what survives poetry, what ultimately goes on once the poet herself disappears, once mortality takes charge, doesn't mean that what survives as poetry is unnatural in itself. But it offers something, what I would probably call a radical kind of liberty to one reader somewhere in the world who might discover this poem, who might expand herself within those silences that you talk about, the spaces that don't necessarily convey meaning, because it's not interested in meaning. It's not interested in defining an experience, but deepening it. Of course, poetry or a poem is language in depth. It goes deeper as it goes higher, and we move simultaneously in that frequency of depth and height. At least that's how I think of it.
Fantastic. Thank you.
Yeah. Oh, okay. I'll once again get to the silence. I became a writer to become a voice for those who didn't have that voice. I discovered that the language was a powerful tool that was grossly misused in the world, not to build bridges between people, but to gain power and to justify it. So I wanted to become a speaker, a port-parole for those people who didn't have a voice. And you can also, you know, most people, I wanted to also show that show the strength of those who are considered to be weak, and because I believe in the strength of those that I don't think are weak, just because they don't have the power of words. But you know, I discovered also that most people want to be in the team of the winner, but I always place myself in the team of the loser. A winner doesn't need anyone to defend him. He takes everything he wants. So yeah, that's a bit my statement of why I became a writer in the broad sense.
Thank you. This is Dr. Jules. So I think poetry as vulnerable, as speaking for the vulnerable, or for vulnerability, for human vulnerability.
I spoke a little bit about this earlier, but I think a sense of, you know, cognitive dissonance as a child coming after the World War II, and you know, a sense of with the bomb as a threat, and a very dysfunctional kind of dystopic world. I also felt there was, and knew this from investigation, that this was there was a continuum. That I wanted to be part of this continuum, that poetry goes back to our first communications. It's ancient form of being. And that was very compelling. And also, as you were saying, Kate, choiceless. It felt very choiceless, that this affinity and curiosity about something so humble, as you were saying, you know, that doesn't take much technology. And then the notion of poesis, which actually the root of the word comes from making, so actually making things, constructing things, that it wasn't always about the, you know, this blast of inspiration coming from above and, you know, the great muse descending upon you, that it was also a kind of work, just as other people work at things, athletes, so you're ready, you're prepared, you wait for it, and then you start to see everything, you're experiencing the world through a certain kind of gaze or a certain kind of, you know, mind that's available for the poem, but you're also making, it's a very interesting way of being, that it's always somehow available, but not always working, and so on. But this poesis, the idea of constructing things, that you're building, it's a kind of architecture, and there are many other kinds of realities and voices that come into that. Not just voices, but thought, you know, the increments of the phones and the phonemes, so the sound within the words, the small bits of sound within individual words, and then, you know, you know of the melopoeia, the making with the sound, the phanopoeia, the making with the image, and the logopoeia, the making with the logic or sense or the word. And so this way of being able to navigate a strange world, you know, there's so much contradiction always, and so that way that you can survive the negative capability, actually that becomes your, you know, your way, your view, your ethos, your way to see.
Thank you. Yes. So we've had vulnerability, we've had choicelessness, and we've also had sharing the spoken and the unspoken. And here also is the delight in making, which is something that Seamus Heaney talks about, the absolute delight in making something, and then sharing that making. Yeah. Tishani.
So I see poetry, the writing of and the reading of, essentially as an act of a kind of transformation. And personally, for me, because I began seriously writing poetry as a dancer, I always receive it through the body first. And for me, poetry is about the body and what is held there, and then it kind of comes out through that. But it's also living in the world and finding a way to respond to things that trouble us. And I think Kate mentioned, or Aisha, someone mentioned sensitivity. And I think there is this sensitivity to what's happening and how must one react. My Patrick Swayze poem is my most flippant poem, but I have a lot of sort of more serious poems. And I've often got asked at readings, like, oh, you must be such a, you know, you sound like you're such a pessimistic person. And I always counter that, because I actually think that the act of writing poetry is extremely optimistic. A, to think that anybody will hear it, you know, and B, just to think, yeah, that it will land somewhere and that it might change and transform somebody's and life. And it does happen, because we have all been transformed by other people's poetry. And so I essentially think that this bombardment of violence and difficulty that we are faced with, when we take that and we make a poem or we respond, we are essentially turning something from a howl into a song, and that is how I see poetry. So I see it as a very optimistic act.
I think also of you know, tales of the great Russian poets during Stalin's time, Akhmatova or Marina Tsvetaeva, and how people would memorize their poems, and these poems became so important in this terrible, bleak time, because they were shared, yes, optimistic communications that life and life and song matter. Vladimir, sorry to leave you to last.
No,
would
no.
you like to turn out to the audience a
bit? I was trying to remember the question. Somehow I felt like it changed. I'm not sure.
Alchemized a little bit, but basically, I suppose it has become, how do you feel, or why do you think you write poems? Who are you writing for? How do you feel when you do it? Where do they come from? Anything around that mix?
Right. I mean, when I listen to all the responses everybody has given, I feel terribly parochial, because I think that my approach to poetry, how I came to it and how I still go to it is, I try, for instance, I remember recently, for instance, I came off of Facebook, and the reason I told myself I came off of Facebook was because I don't think I could have dealt emotionally with the amount of news that was coming in from all over the place. So I started to do something I wasn't doing before, which was sitting down to watch the local news, and just dealing with that for now. And I realized that a lot of what I've been writing, a lot of what I've been wanting to do in writing poetry, has to do with something I think that will eventually result. It gives me a way of to bear all that's happening in the world, but through a smaller kind of vessel, which is dealing with that world. I recently spoke of it as kind of I think of it as writing a kind of staggered epic about the people and the place I find myself in. The Bible is a good example. And epics are a good example. So I think poetry operates in that way. I think that's a good analogy for it, that Facebook thing, where I'm able to bear all the very large themes that surround human life and so on, but through a smaller vessel. And additionally, I think to talk about a more specific thing that I came to poetry to do, and more personal, was. And it's related to the Caribbean directly, that I think the Caribbean, as a poet in the Caribbean, there's a sense in which you have to reach a point where you could re-inhabit the Caribbean, because the way you start out inhabiting it is always very, very alienated. And I think I was able to do that because my father wrote poetry, and my book is dedicated to him. But when I read the book, I realize it is me trying now to understand my mother, who I would never openly agree with, even though in my gut I would agree with her, because she represented a different world. My father represented a world that was connected to, well, he was connected to the entire world, but she had the depth. I spoke of deep archives earlier, the deep archives of St. Lucian life, which brought me eventually to those same destinations that my father would be interacting with on a more surface level. So I think it actually helped to resolve a kind of personal thing that had to do with me more so than my mother, that inability to agree outright, even though I felt that I agreed with her, things that she'd say about spirituality or whatever, that I felt as an educated person, no, you don't agree with that outright. But it really, as you say, the three roads coming together, it really had to do with these very personal and very small but significant experiences and trying to deal with them.
That's a fantastic answer. So we have to stop in a minute, but I think what Vladimir has just said could sum up what a lot of the very, very different and very various strands that have come up, both in their work and in what they've just said. I mean, one of the characteristics of poetry at the moment, poetry in English, and I don't know about Icelandic, but you can tell me, I'm sure from what Indian friends tell me who write in other languages than Hindi or English, is its enormous variety. And but what you've just said, you said something like, I write it to bear all the awful things that are going on in the world, but also to do it through a very small vessel. And I think that is what poetry can do, and poetry can offer the world. Ladies and gentlemen, please clap and really applaud. And you can buy their books, which is what poets really, really like. Please clap them.
Thank you for being such a good leader.
Well, I did my best. Thank you.
Thank you to our panelists for that extremely inspiring session. That was quite amazing. And thank you all for your patience while we worked through our technical glitches. And we look forward to seeing you all tomorrow for another day of amazing sessions. Thank you.